Hi everyone. In today's video, I want to talk about commenting your Java code. We have a lot of tools out there and resources that tell us how to make our Java code, how to make good software, but there really aren't very many good tools that talk about how you write good comments for your software. Today I want to talk about the do's and don'ts when you're writing comments in your code. There are some varying opinions among the community on how you really structure your comments, how many are needed, things like that. So I'm going to share a few of the things that a lot of folks agree on, and then I'll also cover a few things that are more my opinion, and we'll see if I can convince you. Let's go ahead and pull up some code and take a look. All right, so we've got IntelliJ up, and I have the class poorly commented here, and I'm going to go ahead and take us on a stroll through the JDK, because I think that's a good way to explain where I'm coming from on some of this stuff. So I'm just going to declare a string variable. And then I'm going to hold down the control key on Windows, and I'm going to go ahead and click on string. And that pulls up the source code for the string class within the JDK. So the reason I'm doing this is because the JDK is often a good source of what the community guidelines are for how to do something. And for comments, it's no different. So if I go ahead and I click on this little pencil here, that shifts between different comment types when you're reading in the editor. I'm going to read the raw, what's called Java doc here, and I'll go ahead and explain what that means here in a second. So the first thing you'll notice is that you've got a slash asterisk asterisk here. That's delimiting Java doc, which is different from other types of comments. So this first type of comment is called a documentation comment. Documentation comments are awesome. Highly, highly recommend them. We need to be documenting our code, and we need to be documenting what our APIs do. And that's exactly what's going on here. You can see there's a lot of information in here. And what that does is when we have tools that look through the code and can parse this documentation, they can then create PDFs, HTML, whatever format you want. And then a developer can then take that and then understand what the code's doing without seeing the source code. This is a great example of what you want. It spells out a lot of details of what the class is doing without going into too many details of how it's implemented. It's just telling you things that you'd want to know if you are looking through an API, whether you would want to use it or not. You don't have to know the low-level details of the implementation, just the documentation of the interface and the details of how you would use it in your code. This is what you want to do within your code as well. And there are also these C's. These are useful because then they redirect for further reading. This is the kind of thing you want to have in your code. It's well documented and it's a type of comment, but it's a documentation comment. So now if we keep going, we have fields here. And now we're gonna go in and get into some constructors. You'll notice I don't see comments within the actual code here yet. Not seeing much of that. What would normally be a comment within the actual code itself, that's called an implementation comment. You'll see them denoted as a slash asterisk, just one, or slash slash. And those are used to indicate when you want to define a detail of the implementation. In general, and this is where some people might disagree with me, I think that implementation comments often lie, and you should be careful about how often you need to use them. If you're using them all the time, that for me is a code smell. But I'll get into that more here in a second. But we can see that the JDK doesn't have all that much for implementation comments, but they do have a lot of documentation comments. If I just expand this here for a second, here's an example. We have a description of what the constructor's doing. We define what each and every parameter is doing, and then we say what sort of exceptions it's gonna throw. This is the sort of information that I would want to see if I was using an API. Now, if I were actually looking at this source code and I was trying to debug it, it would be useful sometimes if I would have an implementation comment, but in this case, I'm just calling another constructor, so I don't really need it here. If we keep going further in this constructor, we can see we don't have any implementation comments yet, and now here we have our first few. So here's a case where we're looking at some specific business logic in this if statement. If I were just to look at this in isolation, I would not know what's going on. And okay, so this individual comment explains a little bit of what's happening. And then similarly, this one does as well. So these are good uses of implementation comments because when it's not inherently obvious what the logic check is doing, You can then add a comment explaining why. I would even change this to make it a little clearer what it was doing in the code if it were me, but I think this case is a little more reasonable for having the particular comment here. If we keep scrolling, another case that I want to talk about is one like right here. So this is interesting. We now have a pretty long comment in the implementation. So doesn't that contradict what you were just saying, Will? Kind of. This comment is talking about how we have either an optimization or what may have previously been a bug. I am all for implementation comments when you have fixed a bug or when you have fixed some sort of nasty race condition or memory issue or something that would be difficult for a programmer to understand if they were looking at your diff later. This sort of implementation comment is often tied to a bug fix or to a non-obvious design choice such as an optimization. So in those cases, it may not be obvious to the programmer why you're doing something, and you can't just rely on the code to document what it's doing. So in this case, the implementation comment is within reason. Hopefully this gives you an idea of the sort of things that would be good to do in your code. The JDK is a good resource for kind of checking yourself against that. All right, so we just went through the difference between a documentation comment and an implementation comment. Documentation comments are something you should spend a lot of time on and making sure are up to date quite often. Implementation comments, generally, you should make sure that you add if you add something in your code that is non-obvious. But what you shouldn't do with implementation comments is just repeat yourself. If you recall from a previous video where we talked about the DRY principle of don't repeat yourself, also don't repeat yourself between your source code and your implementation comments. Again, why do it? You have it clearly stated what's going on. You don't need to repeat yourself and what's going to happen when you change that code a year later and now the comment is obsolete. Your compiler is not going to be able to check it for you. Today's tools generally don't check it for you. So there's nothing preventing it from going out of sync with the code. And the other piece of advice I'd give you is if you find yourself having to write all these implementation comments explaining what your code is doing, then why do you have to explain your code? You should be thinking, my code should be easy to understand and easy to pick up and maintain. If it's not, you should rewrite it. You should think about what it would take to refactor it. Sometimes you might be constrained on the ability to rewrite or refactor the code. In that case, maybe an implementation comment does make sense. Just make sure that it's not your norm and that when you get the opportunity, you do clean up your code so that readability is one of your top priorities. All right, now back to some more code to go through a few more examples. So I talked about how you want to make sure that you are careful on implementation comments, but that you spend plenty of time on documentation comments. You can see here that I have no comments in this code, and for some of you who may not do a lot with bit manipulation, you're probably looking at this saying, what is going on here? So let me go through this and explain why this probably should be broken down a little bit and how I would go about updating it. So first thing, just to demonstrate what it's doing, I'm just gonna make a variable A with a value of 7 and a variable B with a value of, let's say, 2. And I'm going to print out the result of clear bit with A and B, and we get a value of 3. So I have a value of 7 and a value of 2, and I have absolutely no comments saying what this is doing, and I output a value of 3. I don't know about you, but if I were picking up code like this, or if it were a lot more complicated and I had no idea what my variables were doing and I had no documentation, I would look at this code saying, I don't really know where to start. I would have to start reverse engineering it. And we don't want to be in a position like that. What you want to do is you would start with a documentation comment explaining what your method is doing. So in IntelliJ, all you have to do for that is you type slash asterisk asterisk, enter. And then it autofills some good information for you. This is where the main description goes. So you would say something like, this is where we clear a particular bit within an integer. Here are examples of input and output. Here are the error cases you could run into and any exceptions you might throw. Parameter A would be your input integer. Parameter B would be a zero-based index from your least significant bit. And then what you'd return is the integer after the bit at position B. is removed. So this isn't perfect, but it gives you an idea of what you want to look for at a minimum for a documentation comment. You should have this for any of your public methods or fields for an API that you're providing to somebody. If you have an API that is meant for extension, you might also want to document your protected members. In the case of your private members, it's kind of a toss-up. On one hand, it's really good to have your code well documented. On the other hand, if folks don't have to know the implementation details, the private members often fall into the category of implementation comments. And an implementation comment is one where you got to be careful not to overdo it, because then that just increases code maintenance cost and burden. Because like I said earlier, it's not getting maintained with the code necessarily, or enforced at least. So now we've made our documentation comment, let's think about an implementation comment. How would I document what this is doing? Well, I am taking the integer a, I'm doing a bitwise and over the ones complement of a bit whose value is set based off of the b parameter. So you're shifting to the position you want, and then you're essentially creating a mask for that value. That's not at all obvious with this code. So I'm gonna go ahead and rewrite the code a little bit to make it a little more obvious what's happening, and then we'll see if we even need an implementation comment anymore. Okay, so this is a little bit better. The first thing we're doing is we are finding the bit that we want to set. All other bits are zero within our integer. And then now we're taking the ones complement of that, which means that all of the values that were zeros are now ones, and all the ones are now zeros. So for instance, instead of something like that, we would now have that. And now on this last line, we're doing a bitwise and. So basically we're gonna drop whatever bit value is here within our integer a. So I don't really think I need these implementation comments, because those are specific for a particular value b. In fact, I'm not gonna add any implementation comments here. I'm just gonna add my documentation comment, and I'm gonna call it a day. Now for this one, I'm gonna save the time and not add the documentation comment. I'm just gonna talk about an implementation comment. So in this case, the user of the interface doesn't need to know the details of how I'm doing the swap, but if somebody's reading this code and they aren't familiar with the XOR swapping mechanism, they might say, what is going on here? So for those not familiar, the XOR swap algorithm is a way to make sure that you don't need to have a temporary if you're swapping two values. In most cases, you won't need to do an optimization like this, but if you really needed to, then this is a case where a developer might want to add an implementation comment explaining why. Like so. Maybe you would have a comment like this, maybe you'd add a little bit more or less, but point being, this probably falls into the category of an implementation comment, because otherwise a developer is going to look at this code and wonder why not just use the temporary, and maybe the original developer had a good reason for it. All right, so now I've got a private method here, and I'm going to call doIt, and I'm going to give it a value of 1, 2, and 3. And now looking at this code, I have no way of figuring out what it's doing easily by reading some documentation. I have to go in and reverse engineer and guess what it's doing. I can see that we're doing some math, and I can see that we are doing some logic based off of this DIS variable. But before looking at the actual logic of the code, I don't really know what it's doing. If you look carefully, you might be able to spot what it's doing. B times B minus 4AC. If you've learned algebra, that may be a little familiar. B squared minus 4AC. That's the discriminator within the quadratic formula. Aha. Okay, so now we're starting to get something out of this. Now what we should do is we should better document our code so that somebody else doesn't have to go along and figure out what the code was doing. So the first thing we could do before we even add any comments is we could clean up the code. So doIt is not at all clear what's happening. I'm gonna go ahead and rename this to quadratic formula. But what happens if I don't remember the quadratic formula? Let's go ahead and pull up a reference and then link that in our code so that other developers can easily find that when they look through the code as well. Good old Wikipedia. This would be a good source if somebody wanted to familiarize themselves with the actual mathematical formula and what the different values mean. I'm gonna go ahead and copy this link, and I'm going to add it into implementation comment for now. All right, so now it's a little more obvious that DIS is our discriminant. It is the value underneath the square root. Therefore, if you recall, if you have a discriminant that's positive, you have two real roots. And lo and behold, that's what R1 and R2 are, real root 1 and 2. I'm going to go ahead and rename these, and I'm going to update this result to better clarify what it means. All right, and then we can see that when our discriminant is 0, we have a real root repeated twice. Again, we could go to a source like Wikipedia and confirm why that's the case mathematically, but we can see that this would be a doubly repeated root. And now in this case, we have a complex number because we have a negative value in our square root for our discriminant. So that must be what R and I are. Let's go ahead and rename these. All right, now we've made some improvements to this code. Now I'm going to look at it again. This is a private method. It's the quadratic formula with variables A, B, and C, which correspond with the quadratic formula A, B, and C, which we can see with this implementation comment right here. And I don't need a documentation comment necessarily because it's a private method. It doesn't necessarily hurt, but I don't really need one. And then I can see the rest of this code is actually pretty self-documenting. So I'm not gonna add many more implementation comments. So I hope this is a good example of where we had what was pretty hard code to understand initially, but then we filled it in with some better variable names and a comment reference and an implementation comment, and now we don't need to add many other comments. And we have the benefit of if this code were to change or if we were to restructure something, we don't need to worry about updating our implementation comments later. And those are the basics of code comments. You've got documentation comments and implementation comments. Those documentation comments are the ones that you should spend a large majority of your effort on the comments. The implementation comments you do really where necessary. And if you have too many implementation comments, for me, that is usually a code smell. Either I have unnecessary comments because I'm just repeating what the code is doing, or my code is too hard to understand, or maybe it's brittle because I've made a whole bunch of fixes to one-off bugs in it. Do you agree or disagree with my stance on implementation comments in code? Feel free to drop your thoughts below. I hope you enjoyed today's video. If you did, please do smash that like button. Thank you for watching today. I hope you have a good rest of your day, and I hope to see you next time. Take care.